Let's talk about something that sounds like it should be amazing, but is actually one of the biggest nightmares for an economy: deflation. I know, falling prices sound great, but let's dive in and see why this can be an absolute disaster. I mean, who doesn't love a good sale, right? Cheaper gas, cheaper groceries, a new TV for less, it sounds like a dream. But what if it wasn't just a temporary sale? What if everything started getting cheaper and kept getting cheaper? Well, the answer is way more destructive than you might think.
So to really get a handle on this, let's start with the basics. What exactly is deflation? And why do you always hear economists talk about it like it's this incredibly dangerous downward spiral? The key phrase to lock onto here is the cause. It's not just that prices are falling, it's why they're falling. It's all about a massive, widespread drop in demand. That basically means people in mass just stop buying things the way they used to.
And this right here, this is the very first domino to get knocked over. It all starts with a big drop in spending. When people and companies all decide to tighten their belts at the same time, it kicks off a huge chain reaction that ripples through the entire economy.
So you might be asking, why would this even happen? Well, it's usually not just one thing. It could be driven by major demographic changes, like an aging population. Or maybe people just get worried about the future, expect to earn less, and decide to save every penny. Sometimes it's as simple as everyone having so much debt that most of their paycheck is already gone before they even think about buying something new.
And the next step is pretty logical, right? When millions of people all cut back on their spending, the total demand for, well, for everything just plummets. It's a simple consequence, but a really powerful one.
And this leaves businesses in a really tough spot. Suddenly, they're staring at warehouses and store shelves just packed with stuff they can't sell. They made all these products expecting people to buy them, but that demand just vanished.
And there it is, the final domino. To get rid of all that unsold inventory, what else can companies do? They're forced to slash prices. And when that's happening across the board, in practically every industry, well, that's deflation. That's the downward spiral.
And listen, this isn't just some abstract economic theory. This is real. Just look at Japan back in the 1990s. They got trapped in this brutal deflationary period that became known as the Lost Decade. It led to stagnant growth for years. And right now, we're hearing some eerily similar, worrying reports about falling prices coming out of China.
Okay, so if you're a government staring down this economic monster, what's your game plan? The first playbook they usually reach for involves something called fiscal policy. Let's take a look at what's in that toolkit.
It really boils down to two main moves. The government can either start spending a bunch of money itself, think big infrastructure projects, to create demand, or they can cut taxes, hoping that if they leave more money in your pocket, you'll go out and start spending again.
Sounds simple enough, right? But here's the catch. In reality, these policies can be incredibly slow. It takes forever for new projects to get approved and for tax cuts to actually make their way through the system. And of course, both of these options can rack up some serious government debt, so it's definitely not a quick or easy fix.
So since the government's tools are kind of slow and clunky, another big player has to jump into the ring to try and make a more immediate impact: the central bank. And their approach is all about monetary policy.
And their go-to move? Well, you could say the answer is to basically print more money. Now, they're not literally firing up the printing presses 24/7, but the effect is pretty much the same. Their main weapon is to just rapidly increase the amount of money flowing through the economy.
Okay, so here's the magic behind it. It's kind of like a seesaw. When the central bank floods the system with a ton of new money, that's the first bar, the money supply, going way up. The price of borrowing that money, which is the interest rate, has to go down. It's just simple supply and demand.
And the whole point of that is to kick off a brand new positive chain reaction. Lower interest rates make it way cheaper for businesses to borrow money for new factories or equipment. That investment creates jobs and boosts demand, and hopefully that's enough to pull the whole economy back from the brink.
Okay, so we keep using this phrase, print money, but if they're not actually printing stacks of cash, how does the central bank do it? How do they get all this new money into the economy? Let's pop the hood and see how the machine actually works.
It's basically a three-step dance. First, the central bank goes out into the open market and buys up assets, usually government bonds, from big commercial banks. Second, and this is the really wild part, it pays for these bonds with new money that it literally creates electronically, just out of thin air. Finally, all that new cash flows into those commercial banks, and from there, it gets lent out and trickles into the broader economy.
And the result? Bam! Just like that, the total amount of money circulating in the economy gets a massive boost. And that's exactly what they wanted.
This all sounds like a pretty incredible solution, right? A powerful tool to fix a huge problem. But, and there's always a but, it's really seen as a short-term fix. Which brings us to one final, lingering question.
Look, there's no doubt that in the moment, this strategy can work. It gets the job done. It pushes down those interest rates, it encourages investment, and it can successfully fight off the immediate danger of a deflationary spiral.
So the immediate disaster is avoided. The economy is stimulated, at least for now. But what happens next? What are the long-term consequences of flooding the entire financial system with all this newly created money? Well, that's the big question we'll have to tackle next.